Thank you so much, Sister Tuli. Thank you so much, Sister Tuli, for taking us to the throne of grace in prayer. Without any further ado, to give our pastor much time, thank you so much for greeting him in your languages and also giving him and lifting him to God in prayer in your silent prayers. Please let us remember to pray for our pastor in our hearts as we are going to be listening to the word of God this morning. In the Bele language, where I am married, when they greet me in the morning, they say, Sivugile, Sivugile, Pastor, may you take us to the throne of grace. Amen.
Amen. Molweni, Dumelang. Thank you so much for the opportunity to share the word of God this morning. And we want to thank the Lord for these opportunities to share together on these platforms, because we understand that there is coming a time when it will be harder for us together, whether physically or virtually, to share God's word together. And I pray that it will not be fulfilled what is written in Testimonies Volume 5, that the work that we have failed to do in a time of peace, we will have to do in the most discouraging and forbidding circumstances. So may God help us and may God guide us. Please go with me to the book of Revelation, chapter 14. Revelation chapter 14. In these verses, the Bible says, "And I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people, saying with a loud voice, Fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment has come, and worship him that made heaven and earth, the sea, and the fountains of waters." So the Bible here is very clear, and it is calling us to actually fear God and to give glory to him, which is the title for this message, or for the message for this morning. Fear God and give glory to him. And we looked yesterday at the context in which these words are spoken. It is when fear is actually induced in the world through the rise of the second beast, which points people back to the first beast. And people have been glorifying the beast and saying, who is like unto the beast, who is able to make war with him? Now, another thing that you want to notice in the book of Revelation is that all the books of the Bible meet and end at the book of Revelation. That's what inspiration says. This is found in Testimonies to Ministers and Gospel Workers. So we are told, and it has been seen more than 500 verses in the book of Revelation are actually direct quotes or allusions to concepts in the Old Testament, to portions of verses or to whole verses in the Old Testament. And then we want to look at what the Bible says briefly on the concept of fearing God. What does the Bible teach us about fearing God? How can we fear God? Does this mean that when God, when we hear the name of God, we should tremble? Does it mean that we should actually hide away? Should we be scared of God, if I may put it that way? What does it mean? What does it mean to glorify God? Is it to go to church and sing hymns and raise our hands? Or is there something deeper that the Bible teaches when it teaches us to fear God? Go with me to the book of Psalm 132 to actually learn more about God and his fear. How do we fear God? In Psalm 130 verse 4, the Bible says, "But there is forgiveness with thee, that thou mayest be feared." So here the Bible tells us that there is forgiveness with thee, that thou mayest be feared. So this is interesting. that the Bible tells us that there is forgiveness with God so that we can fear him. So what leads us to fearing God is when we have actually experienced his forgiveness, according to this verse. We cannot experience the fear of God without having experienced the power of his forgiveness. So this points us to the grace of God that has been manifested to us through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Because without the sacrifice of Jesus Christ on Calvary, there would be no forgiveness for the sinner. But God has extended forgiveness to us through the life and death of Jesus Christ, so that we can receive forgiveness for our sins, because the penalty for our transgressions has been paid through Jesus Christ. So the Bible is very clear here that there is forgiveness with God so that he may be feared. So in order for us to experience the fear of God, like I said, we need to experience his forgiveness. So now, here's something very important also that we learn in the Bible when we are studying the concept of the fear of God. What does it mean to fear God? Turn with me to the book of Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy, and we are going to look here at chapter 6. Deuteronomy chapter 6, again, on this issue of fearing God. It says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your might. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently to thy children, and shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the way, when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. And thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thine hand, and they shall be as frontlets between thine eyes. And thou shalt write them upon the posts of thy house and on thy gates. And it shall be, when the Lord thy God shall have brought thee into the land which he sware unto thy fathers, unto Isaac and to Jacob, to give thee great and goodly cities, which thou buildest not." So he continues here. But here, how is this connected with the fear of God? You might ask yourself, because nothing is said about the fear of God. If you go earlier now to verse 2, the Bible says that thou mayest fear the Lord thy God to keep all his statutes and his commandments, which I command thee, thou and thy son and thy son's sons, all the days of thy life, that thy days may be prolonged. So the Bible tells us here that to actually fear God is related with obedience to God. The Bible is very clear that fearing God is connected with actually obeying God and being obedient. But now, the reason why I read verse 4 to verse 9 is very important, because here the Bible shows us that, number one, we need to love God. So the basis of our obedience to God is not in order for us to be saved, but it is driven out of love for what God has done for us. Remember, the first element that we read about fearing God is that the fear of God comes to us when we have experienced his forgiveness, when we have experienced his grace in our lives. But that love, that forgiveness, begets a love in our hearts. And when we love God with all our heart, with all our mind, with all our soul, then the word of God, the commandments of God, the statutes of God will be a delight to us. And we will be, as it was said in the book of Psalms, prophetically about Jesus, we will say with Jesus, "I delight to do thy will, O my God. Yea, thy law is within my heart." Now, the Bible speaks about the law of God being written in our hearts, in our minds, being on our hands, and speaking of the law of God when we rise up, when when we sleep. Basically, the Bible is trying to teach us here that the principles of God's word, the principles of God's law should be embedded in every fiber of our being. They should control and direct every area of our lives, our eating, our drinking, our thinking, our speaking, our interactions with people when we are outside of our house, our interactions with our families, when we're actually sitting in the family table, when we are discussing, when we are deliberating, when we are having happy moments in our family. The principles of God's law and of God's word should be the ones that govern us. And notice that the Bible here does not only say that we obey God, but it says your son and your son's son. That means that we need to establish a legacy of obedience to God. We need to train our children. And when they are grown, we need to train them to be able to train their own children when they have children. So that we need to bequeath a legacy of obedience to God from one generation to another. I hear people talking about breaking generational curses. We need to go beyond that. We need to go beyond breaking generational curses to actually creating, by the grace of God, generational blessings. So that the blessings, you know, when God spoke to Abraham, he did not only promise to bless Abraham, he promised to bless him and his son's son for generations to come. So the Bible says that keeping mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments, and thousands there is speaking about generations, because remember it says about those who don't reverence God and who disobey God, that they will be visited, their iniquities will be visited upon the father and upon the son and upon the son's son unto the third and fourth generation. So now, and then God actually says that he will bless to thousands of them that love him and keep his commandments. So God wants us to create a legacy of obedience to him. We need to lead our families to loving God, to obeying him, not just from a sense of duty, not because we are seeking to be saved, but because we've been saved by faith in the grace of God manifested through Jesus Christ. And because of that, love springs forth from our hearts, and our spontaneous response to God is that of forgiveness. And when we lay before our children the story of redemption, you know, my little one, Iana, as she is, whenever she says, Father, she says, Papa, remember Jesus? She has this thing now of saying, remember this when she speaks, because she hears stories about Jesus. She's two. And I say, yes, I remember Jesus. He is the one who died on the cross for your sins and for mine. And as little as she is, I teach her what Jesus has done for her. And you'll be amazed at the things that these children grasp, even at their ages. Are we together, friends? As they sing these songs of Zion in church, as they sing them at home, you know, we need to teach them the meanings of these songs so that they can attach meanings to the song so that they can grow up to love and obey God. You know, when we teach our little one here at home to obey God or to obey us, we tell them that we are actually teaching them, we tell her that we are teaching her to obey God by obeying us. Because if she can learn to obey us as her parents, and she has seen how we love her, how we take care of her, how we feed her, then there is a greater God who is above us, who has provided for them, for her, first of all, parents to take care of her, who has provided everything that she has. And therefore, she should be driven by love and appreciation for that love of God and be led to obey God. So friends, when the Bible calls us to fear God, it is calling us to love him, to obey him from the heart, to not only obey him, to allow the principles of God, the principles of the law of God to govern every area of our lives. And lastly, as we look at this thing of fearing God, because time is ticking by so quickly, go with me to Psalm 34. and verse 11, Psalm 34 and verse 11. The Bible says here in Psalm 34 and verse 11, come, you children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. So here the psalmist, David, is going to teach us the fear of the Lord. What man is he that desires life and loves many days, that he may see good? Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking guile. Depart from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. So here David says, okay, this is how you fear God. So you keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking guile. You depart from evil, but you don't only avoid the negative, but you also do good. You pursue peace. You seek it. Those who fear God are peacemakers. Those who fear God are pursuers of peace. Those who fear God, they don't only have a profession of religion in their mouth. They don't only believe in their heart, but they do good. And God promises us here in verse 15, the eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and his ears are open to their cry. Who are the righteous in this context? It is those who speak who keep their lips from evil and from speaking guile. This is what the Bible teaches us about the fear of God. There's a lot that we can learn, friends, about the fear of God. And when we learn about the hour of his judgment tomorrow, we're going to learn that it is also connected with the issue of judgment as well. Now, the Bible also says, give glory to him. The Bible says, give glory to him. Now, in 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 31, I believe, the Bible says, therefore, whether you eat or drink or whatsoever you do, do all to the glory of God. So the Bible tells us that when in our eating and in our drinking and in everything else that we do, we should do everything to the glory of God. Everything in our lives should be done to the glory of God. When we have a plate before us and when we have a drink before us, the question should not be whether it tantalizes the taste buds. It should not be whether it is my favorite food, first and foremost. First and foremost, the question should be, does what is in front of me glorify God when I eat it? Is it glorifying to God for me to eat this plate, for me to make this recipe in my kitchen? Does it glorify God for me to feed my family this food? How do we know what glorifies God when it comes to food? Well, the Bible tells us that our bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit, and therefore they should be kept in the best health. We are stewards of the bodies that God has given us in this life, and God will bring us into account what we put in these bodies and how we treat these bodies. And therefore, what we eat and what we drink should be to the glory of God first and foremost. I'm not saying that food should be insipid. Are we together, friends? I am not saying that we should eat food that tastes like cardboard. Are we together, friends? Yes, Hippocrates said, let your food be your medicine and your medicine your food, but food does not have to taste like medicine. Are we together, friends? So that is why whenever I teach the health message, I also give lessons on cooking healthful, delightful, and wholesome food that is whole foods and plant-based, as we have been taught in the different books that we have been given as this church of God. So friends, we are taught that we should give glory to God by what we eat and by what we drink. But it's not only that, but in everything else that we do, we should give glory to God. But there's something very important about giving glory to God or glorifying God that we learn also in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And this is something that is very important for God's people in the end times that we are living in. He says, know ye not, this is chapter 6, verse 15, know ye not that your bodies are members of Christ? Shall I then take the members of Christ and make them the members of a harlot? God forbid. What? Do you not know that he that is joined to a harlot is one body? For two, he said, shall become one flesh. But he that is joined unto the Lord is one spirit. Now listen to verse 18. Flee sexual immorality. Every sin that a man does is without the body, but he that commits sexual immorality sins against his own body. What? Do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have of God, and ye are not your own? For ye are bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your bodies and in your spirits, which are God's. There's a lot that is said here, friends. I want you to notice that when you are having a sexual encounter with an individual, you're not just having a one night stand. You're not just having a physical encounter. The Bible says that you make yourself one with that person. Now, if you sleep with this person and you sleep with that person, how many people have you made yourself one with? What is happening to your mind? What is happening to your heart? And what is happening to your spirit? Now, the Bible is very clear to us in this text that you cannot be one with Christ and then also join yourself with a person that you are committing sexual immorality with. Are we together, friends? It's either one or the other. Now, the Bible tells us why we should not do this. The Bible tells us that we should flee sexual immorality, not crawl away from it, not look back and hope that it catches away from us. We should be like Joseph, friends, and flee from it and make sure that it is nowhere near us. The Bible is very clear about this thing, friends. And God knew that in the end of time, sexual immorality would be a big problem, friends. This is the area where David, the man after God's own heart, fell. This is the area where Samson, the strongest man that we know of from the Bible, fell. Outside of Jesus, the wisest man, Solomon, fell in this area of sexual immorality. And friends, the children of Israel, the snare that was placed before them before they entered the land of Canaan was the snare on the area of sexual immorality. And by the grace of God, we need to have victory over this sin. I'm not saying that we shouldn't have victory over other sins, but friends, this is very important that we should glorify God by making sure that we do not engage in sexual immorality, to teach our young people to flee from sexual immorality. God is calling us today to fear him and to glorify him. He is calling us today to receive the forgiveness of God, to receive forgiveness for our sins, to receive cleansing from our sins, to receive new hearts and new minds from Jesus Christ, to have the love of God in our hearts, to love God with everything in our being, to obey him, to let the principles of God govern every area of our life, to depart from evil and to do good, to seek peace and pursue it. God is calling us to glorify him in our eating and in our drinking and in every area of our lives. God is calling us to glorify him by fleeing from sexual immorality. May God help us to fear him and to glorify him by his grace. May God help us to live according to these principles so that as the world looks on, it may marvel when it sees the people who are living according to these godly principles and say, surely this people is a wise and an understanding people. May God's grace keep us. May he help us so that we may live according to his will and according to his desires for us, not by might, not by power, but by his spirit. Let us pray. Father in heaven, thank you so much for your word, which has taught us to fear you and to glorify you. And we have learned, Lord, that it is not to tremble and to flee from you, but it is to flee to you, to receive your forgiveness and to live lives that are in harmony with your will for us, out of love that is born out of your love for us. Help us, Lord, as your people. You have called us to be a peculiar people. You have called us to be a people separated from the world. The mighty cleaver of truth has cut us from the quarry of the world and has brought us unto a sacred nearness unto yourself. Please help us, Lord, so that we may live lives that reveal that indeed we live near the throne of God. Thank you, Lord. Be with your children. This is a day when your children bring their prayer requests. And we are praying, Lord, that you may answer these prayer requests according to your will. And we know that your will is perfect. We know, Lord, that there is no good thing that you will ever withhold from us. Because, Lord, if you gave Jesus to die for us on Calvary, what else can you withhold from us that is good for us. Please, Lord, be with us now. And we're not praying to you. We do not come to you this early in the morning because you are unwilling to listen to us. But we come to you because we know that you are a loving Father who is always ready to hear the pleas of his children. Be with us, for we pray all these things in the precious and wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.